It has happened all too often. A troubled teenager gets his hand on a weapon, and lives are changed forever. But why? On the Record investigates, and as Fox's Douglas Kennedy found out, the trail can often lead right to the medicine chest.
2 years ago, 16-year-old Corey Badsgard took a rifle to his high school and held 23 classmates hostage.
Describe around that time how you were feeling.
In the morning, I didn't feel like going to school. I felt sick, didn't feel like really, you know, like I could get up very well. And so I went back to bed, and next thing I remember, I'm in juvie in the detention center where I used to live.
Just one more apparently unexplainable violent outburst at school. Unexplainable to everyone but Corey's dad.
So in your mind, there's no doubt what happened here?
And no doubt that the medication did this. I mean, he had amnesia, you know, hallucinations earlier, abnormal dreams, which are all side effects of the medication.
That morning, Corey was on a mix of antidepressants prescribed for what doctors called situational depression. His father says the pills turned Corey from a sensitive teenage boy to a volatile marauder, susceptible to blind rage.
He was never a violent kid. I mean, he's always been a good kid, loved us, hugged us all. You know, he's never watched violent videos, and until the medication, he started, you know, after that, then we realized that he was having aggression problems and, you know, was out of character.
At Fox News, we found the Badsgard story with antidepressants compelling, so we investigated further. We found a disturbing number of recent school shooters were either on medication or were experiencing withdrawal.
The list includes 15-year-old Kip Kinkle withdrawing from Prozac when he shot 22 classmates, killing two, after murdering his mother and stepfather at his home in Springfield, Oregon. 14-year-old Elizabeth Bush on Prozac when she blasted away at fellow students in Williamsport, Pennsylvania, wounding one. 18-year-old Jason Hoffman on Effexor and Celexa when he opened fire at his California high school, wounding five. 15-year-old Sean Cooper on a mix of antidepressants when he shot students in Idaho. 15-year-old TJ Solomon also on a mix of antidepressants when he aimed his shotgun at classmates in Conyers, Georgia, wounding six. And 17-year-old Eric Harris on Luvox when he and partner Dylan Klebold killed 12 classmates and a teacher in the bloodiest school massacre yet, Columbine.
One of the things that in the past, we have known about depression is that it very, very rarely leads to violence. It's only been since the advent of these new SSRI drugs that we have murderers, sometimes even mass murderers, taking antidepressant drugs.
Austin, Texas. High up in a university tower, a sniper shoots at unsuspecting victims in the plaza below as scores of students flee.
Police have apprehended a lone gunman in an attempt on the life of President Ronald Reagan outside the Hilton Hotel in Washington, D.C.
6 hour standoff with police. William Cruz is accused of a violent murder rampage that killed six people, including two policemen.
Jeffrey Dahmer stands convicted of strangling and dismembering 17 young men and boys throughout the greater Milwaukee area.
He's charged with the raping and killing of a 7-year-old girl in a woman's bathroom.
Life imprisonment for drowning her five children in family bath services.
For the slayings of his mother.
The bludgeoning death of her two youngsters.
In custody for the stabbing death of his daughter. Less than 3 months before the murder.
Yes. I just killed my two daughters.
Sir?
Yes.
Tell me what happened. Okay, what's going on right now?
I just freaked out and killed them.
Are you on medication?
Yes.
What kind of meds are you on, sir?
I'm on antidepressants.
I have to say, whenever I read in the newspaper of some violent act, one of the first questions I ask is, was the person on medications?
Virginia Tech or the school shootings or the, my first thought is always, I wonder what drug he was taking.
There are side effects to the use of drugs and also very damaging and dangerous long-term effects, which psychiatrists often don't consider as being important.
They induce violence
They induce self-violence. They induce distortions of reality leading to hallucinations. They induce a whole variety of psychiatric problems, which are then typically treated with more psychiatric drugs.
We're not talking about a rash. We're not talking about dry mouth. We're not talking about nausea. We're talking about sudden, compulsive, overwhelming suicidal or homicidal urges. We're talking about violent deaths. We're talking about crippling injuries.
Psychiatric drugs are rampant in society today. It's become really an epidemic.
First drug that they put him on, I did not like it. He had very bad reaction. He became a completely different person. He was very, as you would say, aggressive.
He became obsessive compulsive, paranoid about bad guys, afraid of dying. He started sniffing his hand 20 to 30 times a minute, out of control rages.
He couldn't think straight, he couldn't act straight. It made him irritable, it made him violent.
At one point he threatened to kill himself and to kill me, and he was only 6 or 7 years old.
From the moment that I started taking these drugs and to the moment that I stopped, all that happened in my life was things got worse. Depression got worse, the anger got worse, the outburst got worse.
I had no idea what was happening to me. I would start quivering and shaking. I would drop onto the ground. I could not control anything.
Within 4 hours of taking 25 milligrams of Zoloft, I was standing on a balcony at a church. And again, there was the thinking, I'm going to jump.
The psychiatrists have carved out a great niche for themselves in the prescribing of drugs, but if you look at the history of treating people for mental and psychological disorders, it's a history fraught with things that don't work.
They're not helping people with drugs, and they're not looking out for harming people. They're ignoring the harm that's coming from all of these drugs.
We see suicidal thoughts, we see suicide, we see profound depression, mood swings.
This is 911. Who is this? Where is your sister? What is she trying to do? Take pills?
What? No, my dad told me.
Hold on, tell me!
You don't want to think that a drug could affect someone's behavior in that way, but it does. It happens all the time.
Suicide is just one in a long list of possible side effects of the medications that the doctors will seldom link to the medication, but instead blame it on the patient.
What's the cause of death going to be written? Not going to be written that the drug had anything to do with the death. It's going to be recorded as a suicide.
There's not a single psychiatric drug out there that's going to fix a problem. At best, it's going to cover up symptoms. At worst, it might kill you.
She went to get the laundry, his laundry, which hangs from a hook in Matt's closet. And instead of finding the laundry, she found her son.
By the time he died, he was really mutilating himself. He carved hate into his thigh.
He had gone into his closet that night, tied a rope around his closet rod, put it around his neck, shut the light off, knelt down.
I ran back to him and I touched his back and I says, "No, honey, he's cold, he's gone."
I'm as certain as I can be that Celexa killed my daughter.
I will always blame my son's death on psychiatric drugs.
Thank you.
numerous reports of significant violent acts, not just suicide, but significant violent acts of murder suicides in patients who were being prescribed antidepressants for relatively minor conditions, and they then just snapped.
The drugs that are used are known worldwide to increase suicidality and increase homicidal violence.
Might there be a link between the school shootings or the extremely violent shootings that have occurred in the U.S. and the prescription of certain psychotropic medications? I think the answer to that is a clear yes.
The school shootings that have happened here over the last several years in this country, most of the students who engaged in this violent behavior were on psychotropic medications that had been prescribed to them by psychiatrists.
Stephen shot at Westside Middle School.
Okay. Do you know who done the shooting?
No, we do not.
Okay.
Like them everywhere.
I was lucky I wasn't shot because I was the only one standing up. My friend Nate got shot in the shoulder.
Oh my God, I can't believe it's happening. There's an eye, nothing like that happens here. This is
no. You should be safe at school. It should be a safe place.
Just horrible images that you never want to see again in your mind.
And I was praying to God for someone to come help me.
It wasn't just my boyfriend, he was my best friend.
A nightmare.
I didn't think he had a
uncle.
Did you see these kinds of incidences in the 1960s or pre-1960? Was anybody shooting up their classrooms? There were guns. We didn't have as many gun control laws then as we do now. No, we didn't. So what's different? The psychotropic drugs, that's what's different.
These psychiatrists are, in a sense, crippling people at the same time they claim to be treating them.
They are mainly just drug pushers. You go on this drug, if it doesn't help, you can try this one. And if that doesn't work, you can try this one.
This is one incredible money-generating machine when this is your approach to treating people.
It's about making money. It's not about getting people better or helping people in a service industry or helping people feel well.
More than anything else, even more horrific than all the lives lost as a result of this callous profit-seeking, is the notion that our country is being destroyed.
How many deaths have to occur before the public wakes up?
Wake up before it's too late.
The United States has a passion for pills, and the country holds the record as the world's biggest users of psychotropic drugs, consuming 60% of them. And pharmaceutical firms are keen to keep cashing in on the multi-billion dollar market, even if it costs people's health, as RT's Marina Portnoy reports.
America is regarded as a country with a ravenous appetite for consumption. Today, a widespread fondness for pharmaceuticals has turned the U.S. into a nation of pill poppers.
Bipolar depression doesn't have to consume you.
Here's me, and here's my depression.
You know when you feel the weight of sadness. You may feel exhausted, hopeless, and anxious.
With over $14 billion in annual sales, antipsychotics remain America's top-selling therapeutic class of prescription drugs.
This is a medical journal.
Dr. Harriet Fraud believes Big Pharma has manufactured a climate of insanity by manipulating and even creating illness for capital gain.
The advertising strategy is to have vague diagnoses and then find wiggle room so that they apply to everybody.
Prescription Nexium.
The U.S. is the only Western country that allows direct-to-consumer advertising of prescription drugs. This ad for attention deficit hyperactive disorder warns that untreated patients will likely end up divorced.
forever.
And this commercial for Zoloft promises to make you happier, but...
Side effects may include dry mouth, insomnia, sexual side effects, diarrhea, nausea, and sleepiness.
Critics also say Big Pharma uses its financial muscle to ply doctors with gifts, cash kickbacks, and research funding in exchange for endorsing or prescribing the latest and most lucrative drugs.
What you have is a whole network of doctors who are hustling these drugs. If a patient comes in with a knee injury and says, "Ugh, I'm so sad. Oh, are you depressed? Hey, write a prescription." They're given out like M&Ms.
Last year, prescription drug abuse became the number one cause of accidental death, with more than 30,000 Americans overdosing.
High blood sugar has been reported with Seroquel XR and medicines like it, and in extreme cases can lead to coma or death.
The number of children consuming antipsychotic medication doubled in the past decade. Millions of American adolescents are taking drugs like Adderall, doled out by doctors to treat hyperactivity.
All these drugs are very, very similar to illicit or illegal drugs, except more dangerous. Marijuana is a little safer. but kids have no choice.
Pfizer, America's most profitable pharmaceutical company, makes antidepressants not only for people, but also for animals. In 2009, the pharma giant paid $2.3 billion to settle civil and criminal allegations over illegally marketing one of its drugs. It was the largest health care fraud settlement and criminal fine to ever been paid by a U.S. drug company. That being said, the money reportedly amounted to less than 3 weeks' worth of Pfizer drug sales. The pharmaceutical industry remains the most profitable business in the U.S. More success and financial gain for the companies will always remain possible as long as more Americans are encouraged to take drugs. Marina Portnaya, RT.
Designing biased trials to avoid negative findings, interpreting the raw data to favor your drug, and spinning the entire study to accentuate the positive are just some of the many, many ways to bias a trial. It is this perfect storm of intellectual dishonesty that has led one drug expert to conclude that it can be proven that most claimed research findings are false. But it is the drug companies that own the studies. And when they believe they have compiled enough evidence to convince regulators that their drug is safe and effective, they submit their phase 3 clinical trials for approval. The FDA only requires that 2 clinical trials be submitted, so drug companies can conduct as many studies as it takes to find the 2 that have the best chance at FDA approval.
You only need 2 positive trials against placebo, and it doesn't matter if you did 1,000, as long as you get 2. And it's amazing, sometimes they actually don't. They might pull data from another couple of clinical trials in order to get that approved.
They don't need to report all their data. They don't need to report all the trials that they do. They only need to report the ones that they want. They can hand pick whichever one they want and then submit just those couple to the FDA.
As FDA Director of the Division of Neuropharmacological Drug Products, psychiatrist Paul Lieber complained, the sponsor could just do studies until the cows come home, until he gets 2 of them that are statistically significant by chance alone, walks them out, and says he had met the criteria.
The New England Journal published a study about a year ago showing that many clinical trials that had been conducted and registered with the Food and Drug Administration were never published because they came out showing no significant advantage over placebo. So antidepressants are not as effective as they are being made out to be, and the side effects are not as emphasized as much as they should be.
This point was driven home in 2008 by psychologist Irving Kirsch and his colleagues, who obtained every clinical trial ever submitted, published and unpublished, from the U.S. Food and Drug Administration of 4 new generation antidepressants. The results were both alarming and enlightening. In Kirsch's words, antidepressant medications have reported only modest benefits over placebo treatment. And when unpublished trial data are included, the benefit falls below accepted criteria for clinical significance. In addition to this, volumes of effects associated with these antidepressants have since been discovered, including homicide, suicide, and mass murder.
People really don't realize that from the beginning there's been a question of how marginal marginally efficacious these drugs really are, apart from placebo.
And yet we have horrific side effects. Combine the two, and where's your risk-to-benefit ratio? It's down the toilet.
But psychiatrists dismissed Kirsch's study because psychotropic drugs are big business, and clinical trials are a big part of that business. Take, for example, Martin Keller, former chair of the psychiatry department at Brown University, lead author of the so-called Paxil 329 study. This clinical trial, which tested hundreds of children on the antidepressant Paxil, found that the drug was generally well tolerated and effective, which in scientific terms is glowing praise. And the study's list of co-authors, 22 of the most prominent key opinion leaders in psychiatry.
I mean, that was a lot of people, but they were the who's who of psychiatry. And this was going to be a publication that I think, you know, took them, you know, into the end zone on getting their approval for kids.
With the FDA's blessing, Paxil became a blockbuster in the child and adolescent market, with sales of $55 million in 2002. It wasn't until the New York State Attorney General's office sued in 2004 that the truth finally came out. The raw data showed that not only was Paxil no more effective than placebo, but the young patients on Paxil were 6 times more likely to have suicidal thoughts. In fact, this data also revealed that 11 of the 93 children on the study developed serious side effects, of whom 7 had to be hospitalized. But according to Keller's own administrator, many of those children were either dropped from the study or coded as non-compliant to avoid having to be counted. While admitting no guilt, the drug company settled out of court for $2.5 million, less money than Paxil was grossing every 7 hours. Hundreds of civil suits followed, but when Dr. Keller, as lead author of the Paxil 329 study, was deposed by attorneys, he would not admit to much.
I can't remember exactly what I said. I don't remember anything specific about any of these meetings. If my name wasn't on the top, I wouldn't remember ever having seen it. If I saw them, I don't remember. The answer is, I don't remember. I don't recall if I was. I don't recall asking him, which isn't to say that I didn't.
I want to pick up on the question Mr. Coffin asked you about the fivefold increase of the Paxil kids experiencing suicidality over the placebo kids. Do you recall those questions?
I do.
And you said that you weren't particularly aware of that except for with regard to a manuscript that was sent to you in confidence by GSK?
Correct.
That actually is not correct, though. I mean, this was an issue that had been presented to you by a number of different reporters that you personally responded to. Is that correct?
I don't remember.
How could Dr. Keller have known so little about the drug study of which he was lead author and which he himself used to promote Paxil for children in prominent medical journals and conferences?
The ultimate publication of Study 329 was ghostwritten by an agency hired by GlaxoSmithKline, and eventually they, after the manuscript was written, they put Martin Keller's name on it as an author.
You know, there again, and maybe you can tell me where I can find it in the paper.
No, I'm asking you if you were aware.
I don't remember the specifics.
And then we finally showed him a document from GlaxoSmithKline where GlaxoSmithKline says that the study was entirely flawed. It was a complete failed study, and it certainly didn't show that Paxil was remarkably efficacious for treating children and adolescents in depression.
Can you read that into the record, please?
Essentially, the study did not really show Paxil was effective in treating adolescent depression, comma, which is not something we want to publicize.
We asked him, with that information now, you know, how can you tell us that it would be okay and safe to give a kid Paxil? And he couldn't answer the question. He sat back, he put his head in his hands, and for, you know, the longest 2 minutes sat there silent.
During the last 2 years of his Paxil study, Keller personally pocketed $1 million in drug company money, none of which he disclosed in his published research.
When people look at the field of psychiatry, and they hear all these reports in the New York Times and Boston Globe, and they see this psychiatrist or this psychologist, you know, took money and didn't disclose it. They wonder, well, is this causing a biases, you know, in the field? I think that's a legitimate concern of the public because of the fact that it is true.
With this level of corruption pervading the testing of psychotropic drugs, one is left with the question, where are those who are entrusted with our protection? Government regulators are supposed to watch out for patients' welfare. So why are so many dangerous psychotropic drugs being allowed on the market? At one point, the U.S. Food and Drug Administration was considered the gold standard in drug safety. But this is no longer the case with psychotropic drugs, where psychiatrists and drug companies have virtually taken over the approval process. FDA drug advisory panels that recommend the approval of psychotropic drugs have long been filled with psychiatrists with financial ties to drug companies. One study showed that 92% of FDA advisory meetings in the last decade included at least one member with conflicts of interest. In response to the accusation of conflict of interest, the FDA says that they have tried to find mental health experts without drug industry connections, but can't locate any. To solve this, they issue waivers, where a psychiatrist is allowed to sit on a psychotropic drug advisory panel, despite having a financial conflict of interest of up to $50,000 a year with drug companies.
The advisory panels that review drugs, most of these people are direct recipients of money from usually the drug under study, the company that's submitting the drug, and they waive the conflicts most of the time. So it's pretty pervasive, and it's quite insidious.
But the one thing that nobody is talking about, the one thing they're not talking about, is the role of psychotropic drugs, psychiatric drugs. And since 1962, 30 states that had mass killings and is directly related to the increased use of psychiatric or psychotropic drugs. So these people, mentally ill people, are using drugs. And most of these drugs are 5 to 10 times more prone for violent behavior as a side effect. That's what's happening. Big Pharma, this Virginia Tech killing, 23 people were killed. However, the medical records were never opened up. It remains to be seen if Adam Lanza's medical records and what he was using in regards to drugs will ever be opened up. Big Pharma is involved in this. Not this isn't NRA, it's Big Pharma. We're a drug-induced society, and a lot of these drugs have side effects. Nobody is talking about that.
Well, who runs Congress? Who funds these presidential candidates? Big Pharma does. It's big money. So basically, why weren't the medical records of the Virginia Tech killer opened? Big Pharma rules. Corporocracy rules. They'd much rather blame the NRA or have the fight in the NRA's territory, NRA, National Rifle Association, than drag in Big Pharma. So the thing you need to be looking for, will the medical records of Adam Lanza be opened up? That's what we should be demanding. That's the big outrage that's going on. How many people and children are on psychotropic drugs, and what is their side effect?
A woman has barricaded herself and her daughter inside their home.
State officials came to the house to remove the daughter from the home. That's according to a family member out here on the scene.
Godboldo came to the attention of Child Protective Services after she decided to stop giving her 13-year-old controversial antipsychotic medication.
The mom refuses to give her daughter medication because the drugs caused her to become violent.
The Department of Human Services attempted to take the child from the the mother.
Godbaldo barricaded herself in her home, and this lasted 10 hours.
Mary Ann was hauled off to prison for 5 days.
Ariana is now at a pediatric psychiatric facility where Godbaldo claims she's being abused. Community groups have rallied on behalf of the family, saying parents should decide their children's medical treatment.
A mother took the stand today defending her rights as a parent.
That's the heart of it, is the question. Who decides what the best medical care is for a child? The government or the parents?
The most egregious problem with the Godbaldo order is the fact that no judge reviewed the document that can change the course of a child's life. Probation officers rubber stamp presiding judge Leslie Kim Smith's signature onto the removal orders. This is testimony that child advocates call shocking.
That was a devastating, harmful drug that should not be prescribed for this child. And no one looked at that. There are a multitude of lawsuits against the pharmaceutical company of Risperdal right now.
So you felt essentially they were putting poison in your daughter's body?
Psychotic medication is poison.
She was just trying to protect her daughter when police came to her door.
It was terrifying, but I kept my composure because I knew that my daughter's life and her future was at stake.
I did it because I wanted to save my child.
And let me tell you, she is not giving up this fight.
The judge ruled the order removing 12-year-old Ariana from her mother's home back in March of this year was unconstitutional.
After months of fighting, Marianne Godbaldo left court with an order to finally take her daughter home. Today, the judge ruled it was a parent's job, not the state's, to oversee medication, claiming a victory for parents everywhere.
Okay, this is John Breeding in Austin, Texas. It's a Monday before Thanksgiving, beautiful day. And I want to let you know about one of Jim Gottstein's initiatives right now. Jim Gottstein is one of the men I consider a modern-day American hero. He's got the website psychrights.org, psychrights.org, Law Project for Psychiatric Rights. He's considered by many to be the leading lawyer in the world in terms of challenging psychiatric oppression, focusing particularly in the state of Alaska, but his work is very much generalizable, and the website psychrights.org is a great resource site. Jim became somewhat famous in the world, at least in our circles, a couple of years ago when Eli Lilly came after him and tried to destroy him personally and professionally and financially. Because of the release of the so-called Zyprexa papers. This was profiled in a New York Times series of articles, and it was a big deal. And so this is kind of action that Jim Gottstein has been involved in. But now he has profile on his website. If you look at psychrights.org and then look at the Medicaid Fraud Initiative challenging the psychiatric drugging of children, Jim, like me, is very, very concerned about the massive, ubiquitous epidemic psychiatric drugging of our nation's children, millions upon millions. I speak about this all the time, of course. Here's Jim's words. The massive psychiatric drugging of America's children, particularly poor, disadvantaged children and youth through Medicaid and in foster care, is an unfolding public health catastrophe of massive proportions. This catastrophe is being caused by the fraudulent promotion of these harmful practices by pharmaceutical companies sacrificing children and youth health, future, and lives on the altar of corporate profits. That's straight language, clear, truthful. Despite the billions of dollars in settlements from companies like Eli Lilly for
damage done to people in the prescribing of more dangerous drugs like Zyprexa, for example. It's relatively a drop in the bucket compared to the billions of dollars of profit that these companies make. Jim has designed an effort that can be used anywhere in the country in the form of what's called a Key Tom lawsuit, which is basically where a citizen can sue on behalf of the government for fraud committed by or in the act of treating the citizenry. In this case, it would be fraud committed in the marketing of psychiatric drugs for children. And so you can sue the doctors in the pharmaceutical houses on behalf of a citizen or as a citizen. He's got a model Key Tom lawsuit, which models up a foster youth who's graduated from foster care, so he's 18 or she's 18, and is suing the doctor and the pharmacy that fulfilled the prescription for drugs prescribed during the experience in foster care. But it can apply to anybody. And it can go 6 years back in time. PsychRide's Medicaid Fraud Initiative against psychiatric drugging of children and youth is designed to address this problem by having lawsuits brought against the doctors prescribing these harmful, ineffective drugs, their employers, and the pharmacies fulfilling these prescriptions and submitting them to Medicaid for reimbursement. Once one sues over an offending prescription, there is a settlement between $5,500 and $11,000 per prescription. And so you can add up the whole prescription history for that doctor or that pharmacy once you get one case in. And so it can add up to literally millions of dollars for each doctor and millions upon millions upon millions of dollars for each pharmacy. As Jim says, each prescriber may have $1 million or a few at most to lose, but the pharmacy's financial exposure can run into the hundreds of millions of dollars, and his hope this will attract attorney fees to these attorneys to take these cases. Jim lays out the model for him. He lays out the rationale for this, and what we're looking for is lawyers who want to take on this kind of case. Key Tom lawyer is great, personal injury lawyer, but really any lawyer who has an interest in this because of the mission and the purpose, which is to protect our children, and because it can also be very profitable to you. Jim is available as a resource and is committed to supporting this action because he thinks it may be the most significant action he's ever seen and I've ever seen in terms of derailing these guys. You get a couple of these cases out in the public with these huge settlements, and it's going to scare a lot of people off from these prescribing practices. Basically, it's any kind of fraudulent prescribing, and fraudulent here is described as the use of any outpatient drug that has not been approved for the medical condition that it's being used for. Right? Indication not approved by the FDA is often referred to as off-label. Congress prohibited not use of off-label per se, but use when there isn't sufficient scientific support, as documented in the compendia, and there's three compendia, and Jim lays these out. And here's a couple of illustrations that he gives. Geodon is not approved for any use in children. So any time that Geodon is prescribed to a child, you can do this kind of suit based on fraud. He says, similarly, I've seen neuroleptics such as Abilify, Risperdal, Seroquel, and Zyprexa prescribed for oppositional defiance disorder or for sleep. Such prescriptions are not for medically accepted indications and thus automatically constitute Medicaid fraud. Anything that's prescribed under age 18 and you can go back 6 years in time is grist for the mill for this type of lawsuit. And virtually all these drugs, especially the antipsychotic drugs, have very, very limited and narrow medically approved indicators. So there's tremendous room for suit here. The doctor is exposed to tremendous liability, and the pharmacy that fulfills the prescription is exposed for even more, because once you get one case in there, one prescription in there, you can go for the whole nine yards with that pharmacy. So lawyers, please contact psychrights.org or contact me and I'll try to connect you. All it takes is one case to open up the door. We can find cases here in Texas, but you can do this in any state. So that's the appeal, to consider joining in to the Psych Rights Medicaid Fraud Initiative against psychiatric drugging of children and youth in defense of the spirit and nature of our children, and to hold accountable and derail this institutionalized abuse in the form of the psychiatric drugging of our nation's children. Thank you.
Truth is, psychiatrists don't know if there is a cause or cure for any mental illness. The reason is because mental illnesses depend on the existence of a chemical imbalance in the brain, which has not been scientifically proven to exist. However, it is this supposed chemical imbalance that requires medication. In fact, no mental disorders have ever objectively been proven to exist. For example, with diabetes, doctors can measure the amount of insulin the body is supposed to produce and medicate accordingly. But with depression, supposedly caused by a lack of serotonin in the brain, there is no way of measuring how much serotonin is needed to feel happy. Despite the lack of evidence for chemical imbalances, the psychiatric industry has managed to persuade society that there is an epidemic of mental disorders. Maybe you're wondering why psychiatrists are doing this. There's one simple reason. There's a strong bond between the psychiatric industry, the FDA, the pharmaceutical companies, and that bond is, of course, money. Money is the reason why drugs are being approved. The FDA is approving psychiatric drugs faster because more drugs on the market means more money. The psychiatric industry makes about $330 billion a year. How do they do it? How do they convince us that we are all full of mental disorders? They do it with the DSM, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders. Every disease listed in the DSM has a corresponding drug which generates profits for the psychiatric industry. The DSM currently contains 347 mental disorders. Take shyness, for example. You may think it's normal, but in the DSM it's now known as social anxiety disorder, SAD, which requires medication. Worse yet, To increase their profits, the psychiatric industry sells similar drugs, but with different names. And things are getting worse. In 1996, there were only 44 psychiatric drugs. In 2009, there were 174, and every day more drugs are being approved by the FDA. There is a massive marketing campaign to promote them. Almost $5 billion a year for TV commercials alone. A frightening way of measuring this campaign's success could be the approximately 75,000 children in the U.S. currently addicted to stimulants, or the 100 million people around the world that are on psychiatric drugs. Unfortunately, the marketing of psychiatric drugs may also be responsible for approximately 42,000 deaths per year. But it doesn't end there. Half of the people that commit suicide are on psychiatric drugs. That means more than twice the number for homicides. You may think that psychiatric drugs are prescribed only by psychiatrists, but they're not. 66% of psychiatric drugs are being prescribed by general practitioners. One of the most prescribed drugs for children with ADD or ADHD is Ritalin. The FDA has actually classified one of its two main chemicals as amphetamine-like because it is similar in its chemical structure. In other words, it is considered a Schedule II narcotic in the same abuse category as morphine, opium, and cocaine. In the end, the ones who suffer the most are children. 6 million have been diagnosed with disorders with no objective scientific basis. These numbers are alarming when you consider how little we actually know about the long-term effects these prescribed substances have on young, developing brains. But besides the lack of objective scientific evidence to prove the merits of psychiatric medications, drugs generally do not heal anything. It is commonly accepted that a drug only makes you feel better when you're depressed, sad, or anxious for a short time. When the drug wears off, the pain becomes stronger and makes your body depend on the drug, causing addiction. It is important to remember that because of the possible side effects associated with suspending your medication suddenly, you must do so only after consulting your doctor.
What are SSRI drugs?
Okay, that's the abbreviation for selective serotonin reuptake pump inhibitors, SSRI.
Whoa, that's a mouthful.
So SSRI is kind of a easy way to explain something that we doctors don't understand, you know.
Great. Okay.
So we get this propaganda from the drug industry representatives who come and give us samples and wine and dine us and they don't tell us everything that we should know about using these very dangerous and addicting medications that alter the brain. If I had audiovisual aids here, this is a three-hour lecture that I'm trying to summarize here, but those are chemical structures, chemical small molecules that are able to get into the brain and into the cerebrospinal fluid, and then they alter what happens at the synapse, which is where everything happens. The connection between two nerves is where these things work. They disable the reuptake pump, which is a pore that sucks the, for instance, serotonin, in the case of serotonin reuptake pump inhibitors, back in to be recycled. Well, when the drug is in the brain, it prevents the serotonin from being recycled, meaning it's going to deplete it eventually. While it's overstimulating the receiving nerve from this other serotonin nerve, you can see why I could use a diagram here.
Right, but you're getting more serotonin when you take
only
the drug?
You're getting more serotonin only in the synapse.
Okay.
But because serotonin gets not 100%, but close to 100% recycling, it gets used over and over and over again. When you're on the Prozac or the Zoloft or the Paxil or the Celexa or the Luvox, you're not getting that recycling effect, so temporarily you're getting more serotonin impulses on the receiving nerve, so you feel better for a while, but then because the serotonin gets eventually deficient, and it knocks off some of the receptor sites, again, this is more easy to understand with the diagram, you're altering the brain at least long-term, maybe permanently in some cases, but at least long-term, So there are fewer receptor sites. You're getting depleted, running on empty on serotonin, which only comes from food, by the way. The only way to raise serotonin in the brain is to take a nutrient called tryptophan or 5-hydroxytryptophan. It's only two ways to actually raise total brain serotonin. The SSRIs only increase it in the synapse level, and that's temporary, with a lot of damage being done. So that's why there's the Prozac poop-out concept. Mm-hmm. All those drugs poop out. They stop working after a month or so. And so then you have to raise the dose. And now you're getting even more aggravation, maybe a little more effect, but again, that's temporary. So.
But isn't that the typical pattern with all drugs, whether they're legal or illegal, that you have to take more to get the effect?
That's right. Yeah, that's true. And that's they call that tolerance. The psychiatric term is tolerance. It works for a while, and then your body gets tolerant to it, and you lose its effect.
So you develop a tolerance for these drugs.
Yeah, so you have to increase the dose. And then if you try to quit, your brain now is dependent. That's where the dependency term comes. Your brain is dependent on the drug, and you're going through withdrawal. You're craving, or something's wrong, and the only cure is to take another hit. So if you're a cocaine addict and you run out your supply, you're anxious. You're searching everywhere for a dealer to get some more cocaine, or if it's Ritalin, which is the same as cocaine, molecular structure-wise, you're wanting to get another prescription or go to the street. And if you're a Zoloft user and you run out of your Zoloft, and you're frantic to get another dose because you're withdrawing within a day or two or three some of these medications. So yes, they are addicting. Everybody, if they take it for a short time, or if it's a low dose, or you're well nourished perhaps and not on any other drugs, maybe you can take it for a few weeks or a few months and then quit cold turkey without a lot of withdrawal symptoms. But when you've been on it for a long time, or in high dose, or in multiple medications, it's highly likely that you're going to have terrible withdrawal symptoms that may make it impossible for you to get off, or very difficult to get off without going crazy from the withdrawal. And we all know the picture of the heroin addict, that they throw in a padded cell, and he just sweats and he vomits and he has pain and he's just miserable. And then he eventually, may get a little bit better, but he probably hasn't. That's not very good treatment. He needs to be slowly withdrawn. He needs to be well nourished. He needs to be hydrated. He needs to have some nutritional help. Mm-hmm. And yet, we despise heroin addicts. We despise codeine addicts. But we don't despise Zoloft addicts or Prozac addicts, do we? Or Ritalin addicts.
It's totally acceptable.
Yeah. It's the legal drugs, my best example, and I could show you the molecular structures of cocaine next to Ritalin, and the brain doesn't tell a difference. There's subtle differences there. One's synthetic and one's natural, but the brain can't tell the difference between the two. Yeah. Cocaine addicts prefer Ritalin if they can get it in a snortable form. It's a longer acting. They get the same high, same quick high as cocaine. Mm-hmm. Can't tell the difference. It lasts longer. So Ritalin is probably more dangerous than cocaine if you take it parenterally. Taking it by mouth, you don't get this sudden high. It doesn't go to the brain fast that way as it was injected or smoked or snorted. But long term, the dangers are probably quite similar. And yet, cocaine, you go to jail if you're on cocaine.
But you can write me a prescription for Zoloft and won't be prosecuted?
Right.
All right. Thank you.